he was perfect. I mean, he came tailor-made to do this. He was able to put aside any of his personal kind of wants and just be, which is all that was required, really. It's just be in this situation. And it was, I don't know, he pulled it off. I mean, that's one of the hardest things to do. And I defy anybody else to try that. There's another aspect of him that's just otherworldly or inspired or higher. Sometimes you'd forget about everything and just get zoned right in onto what he was doing. It'd be really interesting. And it wouldn't be necessarily the way you visualized it, but something, you'd get something else, but it wasn't bad. It was like, wow, I never thought of that, you know? And, you know, you talk with him about it between takes, and then he'd go and do it again. He wasn't trying anything. It just happened, you know? And that effortlessness and ease with which he just let that happen was, I think, boy, you don't often see that. There's not a performance like it. We got this guy, Tony Bertarelli, on the set one day, and he came in late in the picture because he replaced another actor who had to leave. And he was just walking down to the set, smoking a cigarette in his Pharisee outfit, you know, a cup of coffee, cigarette. He's walking down the set, and he bumped into Jim in the parking lot in his full getup, and it stopped him. And he had dropped his coffee and everything, and he was just stunned into a complete, like, stupefied state. You don't know that they're special effects. That's how good they are. You don't know.
Jim is not just Jim Caviezel in this movie. There's no one thing that has Jim just being him. He either has a wig, he always has a nose prosthetic on that we apply every single day. I had a total of 9 different stages to Jim Caviezel's makeup from start to finish, from Last Supper to Pieta. We had to have a technique that the actor could be mobile in, could work in, and most importantly, a makeup application that we could do in a timely fashion. If we have an actor in facial prosthetics, full body prosthetics covering every inch of his flesh, a beard, a wig, dentures, you start to add up all these elements and you start to add up time. And when you're doing that 25 days in a row, you can't have 8 and 10 hour makeups. You'll never sleep.
So we go into this meeting, and I'm about 40 minutes in, and Mel Gibson shows up, and he starts talking about different things, and I suddenly have this shot back to when I was 19 years old. At this point, I said, wait, this isn't a surfing film. My heart started burning, and I said, you want me to play Jesus, don't you? And he looked at me, he was smoking a cigarette, and he goes, yeah. I looked down, and I said, okay.
In person, very shy, always looking down, and he smokes nonstop. And
really?
Yeah, and but for 15 years, as I got to know him, that he had 15 years that he felt in his heart that God was calling him to make this movie, and he knew what would happen if he did this movie.
And we had to show that. We had to make it sympathetic. I think one of the biggest struggles was trying to make this makeup as real as possible, and at the same time make sure that there was still a human element, something that the audience could connect to.
As much as we knew about the makeup effects techniques that create realistic skin qualities, it still wasn't enough. I approached Steve McAvity and said, what if we take visual effects and combine the two?
You know, you'd put the lesions or the scarification on, and it would be pretty livid. And, you know, the guy wouldn't actually have a flagellum sort of ripping the guy's flesh off or anything. He would just kind of fake it. And we'd have to cover up the wound with computer-generated skin. And then as the flagellum would come through, you'd actually reveal the wound that was already on him. So it was kind of like the reverse of what most people would have done.
So 2 days later, I was in my kitchen, I was taking the garbage out, and the phone rings, and I said, hey, hello. And it says, hey, Jim, it's Mel. I said, Mel who? He says, I don't know, Mel Brooks, hey. So you still want to play this Jesus guy? And I said, yes. And he says, if you do it, you may never work in this town again. and I got quiet, and I felt fear come into me. That's one thing about our faith. When you feel that, that's not Jesus. Then he put his hand over the phone. There was a long pause, and I could hear him muffling through the phone. I could hear him say, he's not going to do it.
That's how it is. You make a commitment to Christ that you're going to do that, and then the devil comes in and sifts you out. And all of a sudden, I shouldn't have had this meeting. I shouldn't have done this. I've done all these things, and people will find out eventually that this is the kind of person I am, and I can't do this movie. I'm the wrong guy. I shouldn't direct this. And so he called me. He says, if you do this movie, you may never work in this town again. I don't want to be responsible for that. And I felt the fear, because I thought of all the nice things that I have, and I realized that God had got me into this business, that my talent came from God, not from man. And so I said, look, man, we're all called to carry our own cross. If you don't pick up and carry your cross, you will be crushed by the weight of it.
And he got silent. And then I said, oh my God. He said, what? I said, I just realized my initials are JC and I'm 33 years old. He says, God, you're freaking me out. And he hung up the phone. But that's what happened. I mean, it really happened. And we go on the film, and it was this long, you know, coming to conversion that I was going to have to suffer.
He doesn't talk a lot, Mel. He's more, he moves a lot. It's like if he wants to tell you how to do things more with his body, the way how he moves, than the way how he talks. There is this thing that's almost animal about him. Instinctive, which is very interesting.
When he's directing and he's watching the video monitor, and he'll be doing the action. He'll be even saying the lines sometimes, and the facial expressions, and he'll move it back and forth. And you almost want to sit him down and tie him to the chair because it gets distracting. You know, he's moving and he's making noise while he's doing it too. So sound guys are going crazy, and he really gets sucked right into the moment, as if he's part of that whole scene that he's directing.
Going about doing this movie was, you know, thinking that if we had done this thing in a controlled set, you would have never saw the performance. It was truly birthed in pain. Oh. And it immediately threw me on my face. So right from the get-go, I had my shoulders separated. At that point, I'm thinking, you know, God, hey, hello. We're trying to do a movie here. You know, I'm an actor.
Right.
Just an actor here. You're letting, you know, the devil or whatever destroy us. Yeah. At the same time, we're getting phone calls and stuff from major publications saying expressed interest that Mel Gibson is anti-Semitic. Again, I go, I was scourged, accidentally hit during the carrying of the cross. My shoulder was dislocated. Up on the cross, I had, you know, I weighed 210 pounds. In the filming, I was about 168. I was so sick, I kept throwing up, had my both lungs filled with fluid, pneumonia. Mm. After the movie was over, many people don't know, and I don't talk about it too much, but I have to have heart surgery. Wow. So I was struck by lightning on the last shot of the day. So
That's kind of a moving encounter right there.
So what I'm telling you, you know, if you want to be a Christian, you know, you're in for it. We didn't really rehearse this. We had a metal plank about a foot away from my back, right here, and I'm standing this right here, and they would hit the metal plank, and then there's 1, 2, 3 cameras on this particular day, and Mel in the middle of the shoot, because these guys don't speak English and we don't speak Italian, so there's a translation problem. So he's telling Caridi, his assistant, to translate to them, to tell him to hit Jim like baseball, you know, like a pitcher in a baseball game. And they're like, what? They don't play baseball. And he's like, oh, cricket. So they went back here and took a run like this. And I'm sitting here like that, and they hit the metal plank, except with that momentum, the whip went over and 14-inch gash on my back. And I went right down like in a football game where you get the wind knocked out of you.
Yeah, you feel a little bit too far away right now.
Too far? What's that?
Yeah, that I believe.
Is that good? You can control it.
Pretty good.
I'm not really giving it too hard, like, when I'm selling it.
That they played, they didn't look like phony Bible bad wigs and all this kind of stuff. Either people had their real hair or they had very good wigs and beards, and they were applied by people that really knew what they were doing. I think Jim had his beard applied in pieces and layers, like with hair. That's kind of like doing a haircut in reverse. That's almost impossible. That's like shoving a toothpaste back in a tube, you know, and it looked real. I was lucky to have Steve McAvity there, who was like, the guy's amazing. He doesn't know how to quit, you know. Sometimes I want to slap him. I said, why don't you just quit? You know, but he doesn't know how to quit. He's really dogged. So he was really good to have there. He's always a good guy. And a lateral thinker as well. If you're banging your head up against a wall, he'll say, hey, why don't you just walk around the wall? And you go, oh, no, thanks, Steve. I hadn't thought of that, you know. I mean, he just thinks in an oblique way that's kind of, it just didn't occur to you because you're too focused on what you're doing. So he's able to sort of like pull you up and go, hey, you know. Great. He was a really valuable asset, really put himself out there, gave everything he had. The guy lost 50 pounds during production. He was like a walking skeleton by the end of it, but he was like a ball of energy. He was just going on heart.
I got an idea. Why don't we let me out here?
All right. Nobody understands me. I need a translator. Oh, you were.
None of that is different. Jim knows it.
Local energy. Now we have these signs. Do you see these signs? All right. Okay, do that one.
I mean, you're working in another country with people who speak another language, and you have that step, you're missing that step of communication, instant communication. You gotta depend on interpreters and stuff like that, so it's kind of frustrating. Everything takes a little longer.
Don't use the same gestures all the time.
Non fate lo stesso gesto così continuo.
No repetitive gestures, use different gestures.
Fate gesti diversi.
And then sometimes it was not worthwhile trying to even explain what you really meant. You had to do something simpler that would approximate that. Some things are too intangible almost to grasp. So you just say, okay, everybody, think happy thoughts, or, you know, whatever it is that you can juxtapose against something else to emotionally get the right kind of level.
You're all looking here.
State tutti guardando verso di qua.
34.
35.
36.
37.
38.
I think it was more my problem than anything else. I mean, people on the continent over there are used to somebody next to them speaking another language, so they develop some kind of other sense that understands. And in many cases, I would be saying something in English, and they would just look at the chancellor and go, no, I get it. And not knowing English, but they get it.
The whole point of this thing is I wanted people not to see me. I wanted them to see Christ. While we were shooting the scene, one of our first scenes with Pilate, when we were alone in a room, he asked me, are you a king? Mm-hmm. And I felt as if, even though I'm looking through my own eyes, it's like something came through me. And I stepped back and said, okay. We had already done this, maybe we shot this five different times. Something happened in that moment. It just said, this is the king who's speaking right now. And I just sat back and watched. And it was like I went on autopilot. And Mel said, whatever you just did, I want you to keep doing it. While I was on the cross, I was freezing all the time, the hyperthermia. The makeup hours were from 2 in the morning till 10. And then 2 hours of touch-ups during the day, you're always cold.
Oh, he suffered up there. He really suffered. I mean, to begin with, the poor guy had to get up at 2 a.m. and then start getting like airplane glue put all over his body, and then they had to glue prosthetic pieces all over him. And it was a very long, arduous process, and he had to exercise great patience. And he was fatigued. I mean, he woke up at 2 a.m. Then he was working all day. He was freezing out there.
It was complete prayer. It forced me into going into deep prayer with God, praying from the heart. And if I didn't, I would not have been able to do it without that.
What could be the most painful thing? To lose your child, to see your son, your child suffering like Mary's child does.
I said, don't explain it to me, just show me. You're a brilliant actor, show me. And he goes, well, it's like this. Got it. I know exactly what he wants.
I've learned a long time ago never to doubt Mel Gibson and the ability of the man. Whether it's Braveheart, whether it's the passion, whether it's what women want, I know the guy will pull it off.
What I thought was going to be the biggest challenge in this film for the actors and for the film was to speak this dead language that nobody spoke. These two dead languages, I thought that was just going to kill us.
What's fascinating about it is when you watch the movie, about 10 minutes in, you forget about the languages. You're more concerned about the visual. I mean, the visual brings you in.
So the concept of the movie, to me, is going to be like a silent movie some way, because the audience, they're going to understand what's going on from images, not from words.
This film shows the reality of sin, shows what he went through for us, how much he loves us.
And this movie is not going to be so easy to watch, because I think when you come out from this movie, you're going to think about it.
I don't know if this will ever happen again, to make a film like this, just because of what this content is. This film, I believe, is going to bring Christians and non-believers to a closer relationship with God.
He told me that he went through a rough time in his life about 12 years ago, and he reached the point where he'd gotten away from his faith, and he started looking at the Gospels, and he started meditating on the passion and death of Christ, and he said the wounds of Christ began to heal his own wounds. That's what he told me. But it forced me into a place that was much deeper than my head, which was my heart, and that's where I needed to go in order to get to that place for people to have any sort of reaction. This film pushes and demands people to honestly say, is this really what went on? Is this really in the Gospels? There are many articles now saying, nah, it didn't happen. Oh, that line in the Bible, it's not authentic. But if it's not authentic, then what do we have? What faith do we have in Christianity?
And the film was fantastic also. Also.
It was very controversial, that film, as you know. Yeah.
He was a very controversial character.
But do you think that the controversy was that it was anti-Semitic? Do you agree with that or not?
Oh, absolutely not. I mean, he himself was the greatest Jew there ever was.
Well, the portrayal of the other Jews in the film was a little bit hard, I thought.
We stayed with the gospel, and didn't. It is offensive, but it's offensive to all sorts of people, and also very promising for many people as well. I tried to focus on the parts where he says, you know, my commandment to you is you love your neighbor. You.
Oh yeah, the character of Jesus was wonderful. That's that I don't have an issue with. It was the rest of them, and Pontius Pilate was too nice, I thought.
Yeah, well he. It was,
I never thought of him as nice.
No, they didn't make him as evil as he actually was in the Gospels.
I never, ever, ever thought of him as nice, but either way.
I walked in, and the first thing he said was, how are you? Come here. And I walked over, and he says, Jim Caviezel, what? How you learned to blame Jesus Christ? I said, well, Holy Father, you know, Jesus is, I like the Italian people, you know. And he says, yes. And I said, and they're very beautiful people. Yes. And I said, I think Jesus was Italian. He says, what? And I said, well, hold on. He didn't leave home until he was 30. He always hang out with the same 12 guys. And his mother believed he was God. Then he
says, he's, I said, you're not upset with me. He says, no, I always believed he was Polish.
She knew where Maya Morgenstern was. I never heard of her. She said, you know, there's a woman in Romania who may have, and then she showed me another film she was in, and the film started off with a close-up of her, a big close-up, and I thought, that's her, get her down here immediately. And was indeed perfect. I mean, I wanted her to experience the suffering herself with a certain sense of acceptance, you know, to be grief-stricken, but not to let it overwhelm her dignity. I didn't want her breaking down and, like, bawling and screaming and stuff, because most people would do that. I wanted her to have almost a mystical connection or understanding with what was going on, with that knowledge, so that she could actually bear it, although it was unbearable. To get someone to do that convincingly, you needed an actress who was very soulful, and of course Maya is an extremely soulful person, and extremely sweet and kind and, you know, and capable of doing wondrous things. And it wasn't much, but it was enough. You know, whatever she was doing was amazing. And she was with child at the time. She didn't tell us that. So she had this other kind of glow going on. I didn't figure that out till like about halfway through the shoot. I saw her waddling up to the set and I said, hey. And she went, I'm busted, right? Yeah, I said, yeah. Yeah, so.
Do they call Francisco, so they call him Frank here?
No, they call him Chicho.
Chicho, yes. Because I'm from south of Italy. Mm-hmm. And when in south of Italy, Francesco is Chicho or Chico.
Si, because before he has the south end of the name.
When Francesco De Vito came in the room, you know, he played Peter. I mean, it was instant. The guy was just perfect. He had sort of childlike innocence, and he looked kind of rough and busted up, and, you know, it was just perfect. So you knew instantly, you know. He didn't even have to talk. I got excited. You know?
How do you prepare
to
play the Son of God?
It's a great question. How do you prepare?
Yeah.
After day in and day out of this, plus the hyperthermia, plus the, you know, I had a separated shoulder and whatnot, it forced me to pray. I had to go to a place of something very deep because I was really going crazy.
You said you went into prayer. Is that something that you believe anyway prior to the part? You are a believer?
Mm-hmm. Well, there's no question that I believe. And I think many of your viewers know what I'm talking about, that why would you subject yourself to persecution unless you know that's the truth? I may be playing Christ, but a lot of times I felt like Satan because I had obscenities wanting to come out of me, and it was so cold. It was like knives coming through you. Hyperthermia. I don't know if you've ever dealt with that.
No.
One day of hyperthermia, you're so cold I couldn't barely get the lines out. My mouth was shaking uncontrollably. My arms and legs went numb. I was suffocating on that cross. So, and in the meantime, you watch people have coffee and laugh. You know, they were very indifferent about what you're going through.
Was that true across the board with cast or with the crew or anything?
No, we had very sympathetic people. We had people like in all humanity. We had sympathetic people and indifferent people and people that were that it repelled them. And watching that at times, you know, when you're watching that, I would want to, you know, burst out in my own humanity, you know, tell this guy to shut up or, you know, take off.
Which was the very opposite of what Jesus did in forgiving his enemies.
So then at that point, what do you do if part of my, well, what I'm a craftsman at is being an actor. Mm-hmm. Where is this place? Mm-hmm. Where does he go? So I had to seriously get into a prayer.
When the film ended, the last time I felt that way was Schindler's List and Private Ryan. I didn't know what to say. And when the film was over, it's not really something you can just talk about. It has to live with you for a while. And then I think it's going to be that way with most people that walk out of the theater.
You said something very critical there. People turn their eyes away when they see it. And what they're seeing is their own sin. And it is not wanting to deal at times with their own sin. It is that hard to look at. But this film forces you to see yourself not the way you want to see yourself, but the way God sees you. There's no passive onlookers here.
No. What part of this had the greatest effect on you? Is that possible to isolate a moment or a time or not?
Oh, boy. I'll be honest with you. There are things that I went through I can't even talk about.
No, sure.
I felt like a great presence came within me at times when we were filming. And this prayer that came from me was, I don't want people to see me. I just want them to see Jesus. And through that, conversions will happen. Hmm. And that's what I wanted more than anything, that people would have a visceral effect to finally make a decision whether to follow him or not.
And that's the only choice. I mean, it's either you do or you don't. You're for me or you're against me.
Yeah. So throughout this, when people put on Christ, when they go outside, it's all non-believers see. And you're going to have people that reject it. And for the most part is that, but there are others that have made a living at being Christian. Mm-hmm. And this is serious, because they know the body of Christ. They know what that is. And for them, it's even more serious. Mm-hmm. And more or less, many of the people, many of our Jewish brothers are terrified. And I hear people coming up to me all the time asking me, you know, Jim, they're Jewish. And they say, you know, some of the emails, have you read these things? This is frightening. You know, I didn't kill Christ. And I said, no. The people standing before Christ and Pilate during the judgment scene does not condemn an entire race for the death of Christ any more than the actions of Mussolini condemn all Italians, or the heinous crimes of Stalin condemn all Russians. We're all culpable in the death of Christ. My sins, your sins, put him on that cross. And I bring this up because it's very important to address, because I want my Jewish brothers to see this film. I want people of my own faith that think it's anti-Semitic to see this film. And I want non-religious people to see this film. This film does not play the blame game at all. We're all culpable in the death of Christ.
You went up to him, didn't you?
As far as just directing the film, it's probably about the hardest gig I've ever done in my life. And it wasn't as big as Braveheart with all the horses and people and stuff, but there were more precise things that had to happen in it. Every sequence was definitely difficult to get, and difficult to get the way you wanted to get it, so that you really experienced it, so you felt like you were in the middle of it.
The actors and everybody on the film was being motivated to put everything that they had, you know, and their best work on the screen.
He's wonderful with the actors. The greatest experience was to get to see him working with the actors, because he's so good at drawing out of them, because being an actor himself, he was really great at knowing how to deal with them to get what he needed in terms of a performance.
You know, but stand up first, like a rat in a gun shot. You ever seen that?
They trust him. I think it's about trust. A lot of actors resist directors because they're probably better actors than the directors are. In Mel's case, you know, he's at least on par with any of them, I dare say.
Mr. Gibson knows exactly what he wants, but in the same time, he's an actor, and a wonderful actor, and he loves and he respects actors. He asked us, he pushed us to express ourselves, to be creative.
In choosing this role, I already made a decision. And how it changed me, it was from the beginning of doing the movie. I knew that this is the way it's always going to be. So that's, and you know, Mel actually said that to me when I took the film. He says, you know, he says, you may never work again, but I could go down in the ship. If this is the one that takes me out, that's fine with me. I'd like to work again, but I'd never been a guy who who would sell him his soul to get, you know, money or fame. Was never my goal. It was to serve my faith, my God.
What is your dream role, if you could pick it? Do you have one?
No, I have no idea at this point to determine where I'm going to go with his career. I believe he's going to pick them where he wants me. So let me just say that there are roles that I, you know, The Scarlet and the Black is a film that I own that I like to get made. It's a film that clearly shows good and evil, shows the good intentions of even men that claim to be good. The bad guy roles that I've read, many times they're bad because, you know, they want to be evil.
Cartoon evil. Yeah.
But people that are doing evil don't believe they're doing evil.
Between takes, as I'm here, they would take me down, and every time my shoulder was locked in, there was a 1,000-foot cliff, and it would hit the cross and would snap my shoulder out of joint, and I was just beyond. And at that point, I was so sick that it would be ripped out, and I honestly could barely feel it anyway. I was so gone, but something was wrong with my heart. And the man put a stethoscope on my heart, and he said, "Mel, he can die." And at that point, you know, some of the greatest things about Mel Gibson was that he was a gambling man. And he said, "Jim, what do you think?" And I said, "I'm going between me and God. This is between me and God, because I never thought I was good enough."
Wow.
And at that moment, it was, "I'm ready to go home." Mm-hmm. So you can take me here, there's no problem. But I knew if I died making this movie, I knew that so many people would be saved.
Yeah.
At the end of the movie, I was walking up the mountainside. As I got up about halfway, everybody's in location, about 250 people. About halfway up, I felt this presence come over me, an evil presence, and it was, "You're a dead man." And I remember thinking, this is the best news. This is where I was. This is the best news I've ever had, because I know if I die, I'm going to heaven.
Yeah.
I got to the top. About the fifth take, the clouds were so low, the thunder and lightning was the sound of a howitzer. It was so powerful that you could feel the earth move.
Yeah.
And I saw two people that were about as close as these two are to me, and their eyes were looking up, and they were watering like they were going to cry. And my hair, I couldn't feel it. And I heard a huge gasp in the audience because they saw something. And I couldn't hear anything. It was like an eye of a storm. If you're in the eye of the storm, your hair could be blowing. It could be 30 knot winds, and I'd never heard the wind blowing. I could it was silence. 5 seconds, 4, 3, 2, 1, and this light came right down from heaven and lit me up. What people witnessed was an illumination around my body and a fire on the right and left side of my head. And for one moment, I was looking at myself outside my body.
You got struck with lightning.
I was struck by lightning.
Yeah.
And there were three groups of people. Pastor Miles mentioned that, asked me this yesterday, was it true? There were a lot of people that were very indifferent about doing, you know, being extras in the movie. I said, yes, tremendous amount. In fact, there were three groups of people, and there were the believers, and there were the non-believers, and there were the fence riders. They're the ones that are very indifferent about it. Mm-hmm. Two of those are bad decisions. But what was amazing is that people who think they're fence riding think that that's not a choice. It is a choice. Mm-hmm. You are fence riding, and that is a decision that one is making. Mm-hmm. And but when I was hit, everybody fell on their face.
Amazing.
The ground shook.
Yeah.
And from that point, that was the last shot of the movie.
Big part of this story, as it was between Frank and I, and how he saw the world. Being a Christian is not easy. In fact, it's a hard path to follow, but he certainly showed me that it's not weakness, it's not passivity, it's being able to look evil straight in the face with love. And, you know, things weren't going right in the business, and oftentimes they're not. But the I would complain, shortly after the Passion, I couldn't get a job, you know, and you can fall into this place of victim, you know, that it isn't fair.
What role did prayer and your personal faith have in helping you shape this role, only the second biblical role you've ever done? And was there any hesitation, given how much of your career has been overshadowed by the Passion and your playing of Jesus?
I'll tell you something interesting. Dennis Quaid, when we did Frequency together, he just says, okay, kid, come here. He's really funny. He said, I'm going to give you my, I know you didn't ask for it, but I'm going to give you some advice for, as an actor. Never play Superman and never play Jesus. I'll never forget it.
Well, you violated one of the two. Maybe Superman's an actor.
I did, but I ran into him again at the Cannes Film Festival when The Passion came out. Mm-hmm. And he says, he saw it, and he just said, listen, that was extraordinary. And, you know, you will always be able to say you did something in this business. Mm. You'll always be able to hang your hat on that. And he said he was proud. Mm-hmm. And so you have to pick the right one, you know? It just opens up. And I don't know how you turn down Mel Gibson. I mean, the movie he did prior to that was Braveheart, and that wasn't too bad of a film.
Yeah, I noticed that.
You know, so I would work with that guy any day. He's extraordinary. He's the greatest.
You know, there's, I guess, my whole quest to becoming an actor, I did it because I... not to be famous. I felt that there was a quality, something in me that needed to be heard, that I could be a voice for others. To do what people like Costner or Cooper or Stewart, you know, a lot of these guys that just, Clint Eastwood, that they did to me as a kid, Stallone, Rocky.
These are all heroic figures, by the way.
Boys need them. Women need to find men like them, that they're not up for negotiation.
Men of principle.
Yeah, and still have a little blue collar in them that, you know, that are still one of the folks.
How do you go from playing Jesus Christ to the Count of Monte Cristo to Mr. Reese, and now, in your latest film, Escape Plan, you play this kind of very sadistic, weird guy, Jim Caviezel. This is, and are you aware of that your writers might be talking to somebody at the NSA?
Well, we just shot an episode last night, and to throw everybody off, the last scene that we shot, we shot it with two different actors, because we have people that are watching. So some people know what's going to happen, but they don't know to who. And that scene that we shot, I literally got the pages at that moment. And it was only five people that have those pages. Only five. Wow. So if my pages get out, they're all marked.
The NSA stuff, did that freak you out at all? Learning how much control the government has and how much access to your privacy and to mine and everybody else's vis-a-vis this show, or you were always sort of aware?
I was very aware of the NSA and the Snowden stuff. The frustration is, when I told people about it, it didn't count. And so if the public is informed through the proper channels, through CNN, through Fox, through what have you, MSNBC, then it's legitimate. But if I were to tell you that, it doesn't mean anything.
Doesn't register.
Well, we were talking about Miss Teen USA. I think a 19-year-old kid, not a 45-year-old, not somebody who was, you know, this is no 65-year-old Albert Einstein here. We're talking about a 19-year-old kid.
Yeah.
Got into
a 17-year-old's computer and did it in such a way that she perceived it to be off.
Right.
And
the computer was open.
Took nude photos of her.
Using this camera there, yeah.
And then said, look, if you don't want these pictures to come out, pay me this money. FBI got involved. We do stuff like that all the time, where you think that phone's off and it's on. Now, those lights don't have to be on. That's just to allow you to know that they're on. But that doesn't mean that that phone is not on. If your computer has a light that's supposed to come on, and this is what this kid figured out, how to make it so that those
engage
lights don't
the camera,
come.
But no light.
That's exactly right.
Has it made you more wary of the technology you carry with you?
I got rid of the internet. I don't need it anymore.
Wow.
You know,
Do you communicate by pigeons now?
I mean,
the courier pigeons.
They can listen. They can listen to me on my phone conversations. I'm much more, astute to what I talk about over the phone now.
My heart was burning, and I miss it. I felt heaven in my heart, even as bad as in a situation as that was. Mm-hmm. Look, after the movie was over, I had to have open heart surgery.
Yeah.
And being struck by lightning was, you know, but I never felt abandoned. I felt like he was there with me. And I want people to know that, even in this suffering, that our Lord isn't going to abandon him. He's very, very real. No. But we need that, though, in order to be authentic. People often are afraid to die, but we're all going to die at some point. If I had a message to give, I would say, we need to love God. We need to every day say, I love you, Lord. He needs to hear it from us. In the morning, in the afternoon, in the evening, because so many of his children do not love him and have forgotten him. And that's not good enough. And when you ask me, would you do this? Yes. Absolutely, I'd do the resurrection again, just for that purpose, so the world will know who he is. Mm-hmm. I will have served my purpose. It doesn't matter if it costs me my life. I'm okay with that. I freely give it, as long as I, because in the next moment that I'm in heaven, we talk about that in the film. It'll hurt for a bit. It's gone. You're in heaven. I said, I'm the wrong guy for the role of Jesus. And he goes, you know, Jim, his name's Yvonne. He said, God doesn't always choose the best. But he chose you. What are you going to do? Mm-hmm. So there's a purpose for all of us.
Living in the shadows, yeah.
You see it in my industry. I go to parties, you see people that just are empty. Mm-hmm. It's not appealing to me. And some people are... would rather go after the things and then get nothing here. This is, having meaning in your life is everything. So being able to have Jesus come through me in the resurrection or the passion or whatever, the apostle of Christ, that heaven can use me and to bring people back. What more could you ask for?
For example, if I was in Hollywood and I had attained all, you know, homes and money and everything, and I had that lack of love in my heart, I would feel empty. And you see many people that have had all the things, and yet they commit suicide. Why? There's this emptiness there. And there was the hook in the film to me was where... when I saw, I never met Christ in person, but when I saw you, I saw Christ in you. He became real. And then I think about that piece and then said, well, the world would look at this and say, oh, biblical movie, but this is relevant now.
What was amazing is that everybody wants resurrection, nobody wants suffering. But can you have the gold medal without suffering? Can you sit on, does a man when he's sitting there and his country's flag is going up, and he's got a gold medal around his neck and he's weeping. Is he going, I'm crying because Nike just called and has given me a $30 million contract. That right. must be it.
Yeah.
Or is it that I see the sacrifice, I see my family suffering, I see them, what they, my you're joined to a lot of other people that have given so much into your country and to people that have given their life for God in paying with their own blood, and you hear the Star Spangled Banner. Much the same way in this piece, I wanted this thing to transcend. If I'm going to do this movie, I don't want to do the Passion of Mediocrity or something that is a little pagan, that he wasn't handed over by his own, that only the Romans were so responsible. Mm-hmm. But if you look at it day after day, that we all are part of handing Christ over when we contribute to sin, especially when we betray him and we are Christians. Mm-hmm. But Jesus then continues to tell us to get back up, to try, to keep going. When you're hung on a cross, you die by asphyxiation, suffocation. Yeah. But physically, I was struggling. But our Lord was letting me feel a little bit of what he went through.
Yeah.
And he was sustaining me, mm-hmm. but to a point of, how far do you want to go with this? Mm-hmm. How much of do you want the world to see of me? Oh. And I said, every bit of it. Well, then you're in for it. It's kind of like, you know, Lord, I want to drink your... Can you drink the cup that I'm going... Yes, we can. Mm-hmm. We can, James and John, asking mm-hmm. that we want to sit at your right and left-hand side. Mm-hmm. So it was given. But, you know, it's funny, I'm in San Diego. When I was a young man, I came out at 18, and I wanted to be a Navy SEAL. I didn't know what Navy SEALs were. They started talking about frogmen. At 18, I told my dad this what I wanted to do, and I applied to the United States Naval Academy 3 times. I was going to give my life, but in a different way. God had reserved that in me. I see those guys when they go through buds, and I said, there's no way you can make it through unless you're willing to say, it's okay if I die here at buds.
Yeah.
So I want to give my life for something.
Uh-huh.
And there's nothing better for me than to give my life for Jesus Christ.
He is here to reach all, not just Christians, Muslims, Jews, atheists, everybody in the whole world. Jesus Christ died for all men. All men, that means every country, every nation. You can think of every color and every race. If people don't come and see it, then, you know, forget about it. Films that get made are the ones that make money. And if this film goes off the charts, you're going to see a whole, plethora of films based in the Bible. You're going to see great films that have some sort of redeeming value. But again, if you want those kind of films, you have to support them. If you don't get behind them, they will not get made.
You don't have to go out and do a song and dance for seculars because they won't believe. They won't believe anyway. You can pray for them. That's the way it's going to be. But understand, people are going to choose evil, but you don't. And the devil is going to sift you out. He's going to look right now. Where are you weak? I can get this guy $1 million and he'll turn. 10 million for this guy, 50 over here. They'll all turn. They'll all say, well, choice, my freedom to choose. Every generation of Americans needs to know that freedom exists not to do what you like, but having the right to do what you ought.
Tremendous.
If you want to look at it this way, the problem I see right now is the fact that many, many Christians have immersed themselves in paganism. They want to be cool to their Christian or pagan friends by being a little pagan so they can be cool. There's nothing cool in this. The only thing lacking in you is that you don't want to be holy. Well, here's what will happen. We'll all come to task one day, and you either get a chance to lay it down for Jesus, or you'll get to deny him. But it will come in our generation this way. There are many things that you see on the horizon right now where you're going to have to make a choice. You will have to make a choice.
Some of us now, and you know them,
embrace a fake Christianity where it's all happy talk. I call it happy Jesus and glory. Guys, there was a lot of pain and suffering before the resurrection. Your path will be no different. So embrace your cross and race toward your goal. I want you to go out into this pagan world. I want you to have the courage to step into this pagan world and shamelessly express your faith in public. We need Christians to go look death in the face and understand the next point, to encourage these people to understand that eternity awaits them. We're all going to die, the first death, hopefully not the second. God never sends a man to hell. People choose this place.
Yeah.
Our democracy cannot be sustained without a shared commitment to certain moral truths about the human person and the human community. The basic question before a democratic society is this: how ought we to live together? And in seeking an answer to this question, can society exclude moral truth and moral reasoning? Set yourselves apart from this corrupt generation, my brothers and sisters. You weren't made to fit in. You were born to stand out.
That's right. Tremendous. Tremendous. So now you've started on a new endeavor. It's actually been a six-year process, the audio Bible, Word of Promise. Tell us a little bit about that project and what it means to you and the purpose behind it.
This audio Bible is the passion of the Christ, but it is the passion of Christ in your car. It's the passion of the Christ when you're depressed and everyone's rejecting you because they only like winners. It's when you've hit that depressive state when you think of suicide, or you've had your abortions, or you paid for one. It's to understand that Jesus will forgive, and he has mercy, and the greatest of mercy. I don't think even we understand what mercy is, or what grace is. You can't be an Olympic athlete, you can't be a world champion by practicing once a week. You have to take Jesus Christ into your life every day. It's who you are. He's a part of you. He wants to be with you all the time. He's the greatest coach there ever was. But he's that coach that when you fall down, he's like, get up, man, go. Then does he push you? Absolutely. He wants much from you. He's the one that encourages you to fast, to not just pray once a week, but to pray every day. And then once you're praying every day, you change the workout because you can do more, can't you? Yes. And he wants more. He demands more, and you want it. And after you make it, you get there. There's more and more. And it's a continual thing, even in heaven, on earth as it is in heaven. Guys, our Father is real.
Yeah.
The gospel is real. It's not something that you just put away. You read this, it's now. The gospel. Some of you are going to play the Virgin Mary. Some of you play Jesus. Some of you will play his betrayer, Judas. And some of you will be Pilate, the politician. Who are you? God will tell you. And then you move in the direction of holiness every day. You're in the car. You're depressed. Right now we're going through a time period where things are being stripped from us. And they will. And it's good. Because you understand, you don't need all the things that we've been given. They aren't your given right. They're going to be stripped. We're living in this time right now where the world is going to be fasting. And it's going to get hard before it gets better. But God, the people need to see God in you. They need to be a light because you need to be that light. Because they're going to see you and they're going to think suicide is the way out. But they see you. They want that. Will you ask me this? But I will tell you what I know God wants me to say.
Sure.
Number one, I love you. I love you. That's what you want to hear, isn't it? Number two, you are all going to heaven. And you say, how do you know this? It's very simple. God had been in your heart a long time. He's been dormant, some of you. Some of you, much more alive.
but continually God is asking for more conversion. Why do you believe? Let me tell you, a man can be a soldier in the military for 20 years and never see one day of combat. But when he's in that foxhole and he's losing his own men, he's on a whole nother level. God is preparing you now for this level. I will tell you how I know that God loves you this much and how I know that you're all going to heaven. Some of you have had abortions. Some men here and women are adulterers. Some have committed murder. Some of you didn't have the abortion, but you paid for it, so you have contributed to this. Many people are a part of this great sin in this country. Over 50 million in the United States alone. 45 million die every year in the world. These are all God's children, and God brings them home. Now He wants to bring you home, now, in this moment. This is a chance for heaven right now. You don't have to wait to die to experience heaven. But when you committed the sin, any of the Ten Commandments, or the sin of abortion, or contributed to it, let me be very clear. Did you go to one of your friends and ask your friend, hear my story? And you say, yes, I went to one person. I said, why do you go to this person to confide in this sin to them? Because they didn't judge me, because they loved me, because I felt mercy and grace. Now, I ask you this. Do you think that your God doesn't have more mercy than your friend? Do you think your friend has more grace than God? Does your friend have more love than the Creator? It can never be. It can never be. So, God forgives you, and now He needs you to begin again, to accept forgiveness. Earlier I said, God never sends a man into hell. People choose this place. Your choice. God made you and loves you. There's never been another like you. He deemed that you would come here. He asked you, and you came. Today, you came. You had the courage to come. And there was plenty parts of the world that pulled you from today from even coming, but you came. Don't you know how much God will remember this? Do you think He is a God that's just sitting there waiting to toss you off? You are perfect. There is no one else like you. And without you, He would cry. So He's coming to you now, right now, in this moment. All He has to hear from you is yes. Yes, you've accepted Jesus, some of you. Keep accepting Him. Every time we sin, we deny Him. Be holy. Be perfect, just as my Father is perfect. Or in the Passion, Ha'ozina otiabui, kuma bezrati, shamereni meresha tesher tamenu alai, bakakasaya nafshi adonai, bakakistiti, bakab takti, ba kuletekehu henkehel kosi de mini, okin lakisfar, lehue di lakisfar, milatil komare hema hakihida. Hita hivu dina le dina, kokaver diana a hevef lakom antun, hita hivu lakom. My commandment to you is this, you love one another just as I have loved you. And if that doesn't grab you, maybe this one will. Your name may not appear down here in this world's hall of fame. In fact, you may be so unknown that no one knows your name. The Oscars and the praise of men may never come your way, but don't forget, God has rewards that He'll hand out someday. This crowd on earth, they will soon forget when you're not at the top. They will cheer like mad until you fall, and then their praise will stop. Not God, He never does forget, and in His hall of fame, by just believing on His Son, forever there's your name. I tell you, friend, I wouldn't trade my name, however small. It's written there beyond the stars in that celestial hall.
for all the famous names on earth or the glory that they share. I'd rather be an unknown here and have my name up there. God bless you.
Fantastic. Fantastic.
I love you.
Dig pretty deep on me, not just the making of it and the post-production aspect of it, but what it did culturally was astounding to me.
I'm a different person now than I was a couple years ago from this film, from working on this movie. My family has completely changed. My friends that have worked on this film are different to different degrees. Everybody was touched. I was drastically touched.
It was about forgiving your enemies, and they understood that, and that kind of message, and that it could convey that to most people that saw it, is for me a raging success, and defeats division, separation, and brought many, many people together, and that was the idea. So it worked.